Look, I decide to give you this overview to turn around the world. All our your countries won't be in the presentation, but I took some example in each continent, as you are from South America, Middle East, Asia, Africa. We will take some typical example. Okay, next one. The first question was the size of the problem and what's the epidemiological trend. Sometimes the data, the numbers are not perfectly reflecting the reality, but at least we see the tendency. You know, if the problem is growing or is going down, that's the important point for the control people in the ministry. You know, and the sponsor know exactly how complex is the situation of leishmaniasis. That's why sometimes we have difficulty in draining money to leishmaniasis, because they sometimes they prefer disease where there is one single epidemiology, one single way to treat, to diagnose, and the sponsor can get a quick return on investment. For leishmaniasis, it's always complex. They say, wow, in the same place, you have such leishmaniasis and the one and the... But that's the reality. We have more than 20 species of leishmaniasis around the world. We have at least 30 proven vectors and 98 countries endemic for leishmaniasis. Some recently appear to be like Bhutan or Thailand. Thailand, yeah, that was not included in, because they were just imported cases. But now we know that these countries have autochthonous cases. By chance, in some other countries, the problem is going down. It's not only increasing everywhere. At the contrary, population at risk is very difficult to have an exact number, but we estimate it's around 350 million people that live in places where they can get leishmaniasis. And the DALYS, the disability adjusted life years, estimated at 2.4 million. That's important in terms of public health to know what's the impact of the disease and what feasibility to control it. The incidence per year has been reviewed recently by WHO 2-3 years ago to update the information. Perhaps some of you received the questionnaire to give update data. And at the end, the conclusion was that in terms of CL, cutaneous leishmaniasis, is less than what we used to say. We used to say 1.5 to 2 million. Now it's estimated at 1 million new cases per year and 300,000 for VL, a small reduction in the previous number. Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry. Here you see the diversity, of course, for most of you is perfectly well known. I just want to insist on this, the mucosal, mucocutaneous leishmaniasis. I heard that somebody from Peru in this place, yeah. This picture was taken in a ceramic museum in Lima, and you see at the same time I was working in Bolivia and I saw a case that was perfectly similar to the pottery. And it's of course the typical CL from Syria, VL in South America, and another aspect of CL. In few minutes, just to remember, everybody works on leishmaniasis here. We have the typical vector, the sandfly here. You know, only the female transmits the disease because she has to take blood milk to lay eggs. Here you have the promastigotes parasite. Here again, the sandfly with the blood milk inside the abdomen. And I had a joke because once in Ethiopia, I was in the plane between Addis Ababa and the province. And there were some old American traveling there, and they were full of mosquitoes in the plane. And I took and I said, oh, that's sandfly. And to my neighbor, I said, don't panic, it's just a male. And he said, how do you know? I said, look, I will show you. That's it. And when we arrived in Addis, she called all the friends, said, I have a doctor with me. He knows even the sex of the mosquitoes. The amastigot. Typical promastigots in sunflies, in culture medium. And again, the diversity at the animal reservoir. We have some little gerbil like this, many from the Tunisia, Maghreb. People know exactly the psammomys, the merions. You have the big mammals in South America, the dog everywhere, in most in zoonotic foci of VL. What is important in terms of control that you have two big kind of epidemiology. You have what we call the anthroponotic cycles, is this where the man, infected man, is the reservoir, the source of infection for the vector, and the transmission is from man to man through the vector. In the zoonotic forms, you have always one animal reservoir. And here I put the dog for the visceral leishmaniasis, but it could be a gerbil, as I said before, or even big mammals. Here, in that case, the sandflies take the parasite from the dogs and transmit to human. What's the impact of these big differences? Is, for example, it is anthroponotic. It's very easy to understand. If you have people that are not treated, they are reservoirs. They will disseminate the disease, and we can see these big epidemics in Sudan, in India, in different places of the world, sometimes very difficult to control. At the same time, it's easier to target human than animals. Because in that case, for example, in zoonotic VL, the dog is very difficult to control. No, we know he's full of parasites. He will die with the disease, but the time he lives, he transmits a lot of infection through the vector. And that's the four major entities we will review with some example in the countries. Just before that, main risk factors for leishmaniasis is perfectly known from you, but we see more and more the problem of migration, urbanization. There are some people from Brazil, typical domestication of the cycle that was in the forest and now peri-domestic. We will come back to that. New settlements, deforestation, irrigation scheme. We will see that in Iraq, in Syria. And all the factors related with the human host, immunological status, HIV, malnutrition. And the third component is also the parasite itself, different species, different tropism or virulence. Donc, it's a complex affair because we can have the three factors interacting and creating the problem locally. And just to conclude with this introduction, as I said before, migration become a huge problem. And it could be in both sides. It could be from rural areas to cities, or from cities to settlements in rural areas. But usually, it's mainly to the cities, to the suburbs, when people live in very poor condition, poor sanitary condition. You have plenty of places that we call breeding sites for leishmaniasis, for the sandfly. And it's very difficult to control these breeding sites. And you see the tendency on urban population increase. In 2050, some people have estimated that 2/3 of the world population will be living in cities and unfortunately, mainly in the suburbs. Now, let's move in. We start with South America, Central and South America, and CL. Cutaneous and mucosal. And you see that the main contributors, unfortunately, is Brazil, although the tendencies, the incidence is going slowly down, but still you see you are more than 20,000 cases per year. And you have Colombia in blue, that is going a little down, but it's the second contributor. Then we have Peru, that is here in Maon. And then a small country like Bolivia, Nicaragua, and Panama contributing. Brazil is certainly the main contributors with close to 80% of the CL cases together with Peru and Colombia. Donc we can target these three countries as the main contributors. More or less in South Central America, we have 60,000 cases per year. It's something important. In 10 years, more than 640,000 cases reported, officially reported. That gives you the size of the problem, because especially for CL, many cases are never reported. People live with. And what is important, this mucosal form, that is very severe is 3.8%. But I will show you an example, I will tell you an example. When I was a young French civil servant, I was sent to South America, to Bolivia. And in the place where I was, in a small village, there was no local doctor, so I was doing anything, but taking care of leishmaniasis cases. At that time, I saw 70% of mucosal cases. Now we are at 3.8. That's very encouraging. That's, if you create awareness, if people are more aware that it's a very severe form, you should prevent the evolution to this severe form, you can reduce the problem. And that's the importance of health education and awareness. Donc here you have two examples. It's in French Guiana, where in the same place you can have two different parasites. Leishmania guianensis, with the sandflies living at the top of the trees, the big mammals here, and the sloth, for example. And at the same time, you have a parasite on the ground level with a different vector. There you see Leishmania umbratilis, Flavis cutellata here, with the proechimis, a small gerbil, as a reservoir. And what makes the situation still more complex, that at a certain period of the year, you have the sandflies going down, the umbratilis. The guy that go into the forest to hunt or to cultivate the extension can get bitten by these sandflies or the other one. But the probability, there were some military French working there, and 70% of the guy used to get leishmaniasis, 70%. And when I told the general, I said, my general, now we know the time, the worst time, you should not send your guy in the forest. Say, doctor, thanks so much, but we don't know the time, the month, the hour of the war. We will still continue sending guy in the forest. I say, thank you so much. No direct interaction, a little difficult. And you see here, the mucosal, one of the severe forms I have seen. And this is the diffuse cutaneous leishmaniasis. It's also a very difficult entity to treat because you have no cellular immune response in these patients. It's a very long-lasting leishmaniasis. Let's continuing. You see the number in Brazil I showed you before. We're still over 22,000 cases per year. I will just show you an example in the central Brazil. Manaus, there are two, three people, no, from Brazil. You have been there, perhaps, no? In Manaus, or not yet? You will be now. As I said at the beginning, the problem of increasing CL, not only in Brazil, but in other countries of South America, is the problem of urbanization, people migrating to the suburbs, or people going to the forest to cut trees and to have their crops, rice, growing. But it's a process of settlement, and we have a domestication of vectors. That's a fabulous example of the city of Manaus, where you see that prohibited settlement should not be there, but it is the reality. The people go during the night, they put the a small roof, and then they stay there. It's a huge, and that's the new one. The government say, no, we should prevent these people to live in very poor condition. We will, but in fact, it was a superb idea, but it didn't change the problem because you see this beautiful house, much better condition of life, but here you have the remnants of the forest, and here you have the sunflies, and you have the animal reservoir. Donc, there was a beautiful work made by some Brazilian colleagues showing that the transmission was still very high, although the house is better than the previous one. It's interesting to see if you have to take care of the environment. It's not only building a house. Here, the reverse process, people going to the forest, cleaning, and as typical house at the edge of the forest. Donc, the people have their little crops here. The gerbil, the rodents are here, and the transmission is, you can see all the family getting Leishmaniasis, old age, because the transmission inside the house. Before, when it was in the forest, it was just the male adults who teenagers going there for professional activities. You don't need any more to see my name. I can remove that. Okay, next one. We can reduce the light. Yeah. But be careful, if you sleep, I will look at you. Before, you know, there were the traditional slides, no? So you have to tell the guy, next one. And when the guy was sleeping, nothing moved. Okay. Now we are moving from South America to, I didn't miss anything, no? To Syria. There's somebody from Syria, no? Yeah. I've been several times, not in recent years, but I've been in Aleppo, in Homs, in Baghdad. And you see the number of cases is increasing, unfortunately, due to the unstable situation, the war situation. It's a little out of control. Here you see the graphic that shows this increase of cases in Syria. The last number I have is 2012. Well, it should be the same, more or less. Worst. And here you see the map. It's interesting because in the same country, you can have anthropognathic cutaneous leishmaniasis, transmission man to man through the vector, and zoonotic, ZCL, that is the one with the gerbil. Donc, I will show you one example of ACL and one of ZCL. You see all the Kurdish area in the north also is highly endemic for leishmaniasis. We used to work close to the border of Turkey. It's Aleppo, and you have even Damascus, sorry, is endemic focus for ACL in the suburbs. And here you see the current is a very well updated map to see the refugee camp, no? All the people that unfortunately had to move outside the country, and now they settle in Turkey, they settle in Jordan mainly, and Lebanon. Now the cases are reported from this refugee camp, and the quantity of cases is huge. Let's start with ZCL. ZCL in the whole world. You have always these gerbils, different species of rodent living in the burrows. And you have different vectors. You see Phlebotomys papatasi, Dubosky salii, depends which area. In Syria, Middle East is papatasi. And then you have the human that infected, and the parasite is Leishmania major. Let's go into, let's say, to Syria, to the very nice place where, when I was some years ago, on the Euphrates River, it's called Deir ez-Zor. And you see, it's very interesting because in dark green, you have the initial irrigation area. And now, in a clear green, the new ones. It was duplicate, triplicate, because of course you need water to have a good crops. But what people didn't anticipate, that creates leishmaniasis, because irrigation scheme means good crops, good rodents, and then transmission. And I saw many cases. It's a little clear, but I think if we put the darkness, perhaps it will be difficult to maintain you with the open eyes. Be careful, you have a good vision. Perhaps, yeah, for a moment, perhaps we can. And this is especially in the resort where, when I was there, I saw the system for irrigation to take the water from the Euphrates River. And then you have the gerbil here, the burrows, and see the increase of cases. That was typical. And I visited a school in the resort, and 80% of the students had leishmaniasis at the school. And the teacher who arrived 3 months before, he showed me, said, "Doctor, is that leishmaniasis?" I said, "Yes, it is." Look, all the people were getting the disease. Now, anthropognathic, I say, is the untreated cases, which is the reservoir. the sandfly pick up the parasite and transmit to other one. Parasite Leishmania tropica, one vector, phlebotomy sergenta. And here you have a very specific form that we call Leishmania recidivans. It's a case with relapse and create a chronic reservoir for the disease. And sometimes, in some places, it's just enough to have some cases of Leishmania recidivans going to the new place and creating a new focus, because they are so infective that if you have sandflies there, they start picking up the parasite and transmitting. Another example in Syria. That's Aleppo suburbs, when I used to go frequently. And you see in some areas, you have the poor sanitary condition with open sewage. And these areas are full of breeding sites. No? And it's very difficult to control the situation. The ministry was doing a lot of work for leishmaniasis, but it was very difficult. Now, Afghanistan. I think we have nobody from Kabul, but neighboring countries, no? Pakistan. Look, you see also the situation becoming very severe and very difficult to control. Where is, you see here, more than 30,000, 35,000 cases per year. And you have also ACL and ZCL, mainly ACL. And the big cities, Kandahar in the south, Kabul, Herat. And you see this place? It's the place where I almost died, because I went from Pakistan, Peshawar. And then I enter with five bodyguards to Afghanistan. But on the road, we were not attacked, but it was limit. They say, you come back quickly, and we don't want to see you again. Yeah. I say, of course, let's go. And you know why I was in this difficult area? In a few seconds, I can tell you. Because at that time, the Americans were bombing here in Pakistan, in Afghanistan, the mountains, because Al-Qaeda, no? They were supposed that Bin Laden was supposed to be there. And then, in Pakistan, many people appear with skin disease. And of course, the people said that's due to American bombing. And the WHO representative in Pakistan, he was a friend, he called me, said, Philip, you have to come because I think it's leishmaniasis. Okay, I went directly there, and 2 days I was there. We took samples, they were analyzed, Leishmania tropica. Look, the WHO was so happy, went to the Ministry of Health, he said, look, you have to publish a paper, it's leishmaniasis, Leishmania tropica. And the kind of things you can do, I was not really taking care of the regional office and they think they were furious because Geneva directly to Afghanistan or Pakistan. But it's good. And you see all the areas where you have in Afghanistan, it's very endemic, especially for ACL. And in the north, you have some foci of ZCL. And why there's so much leishmaniasis in Afghanistan? One reason, the major one, is because the instability, the civil war during many years, people moving from. And an interesting point is this. That's the refugee camp in Pakistan, because many people move outside Afghanistan. They settle there, and they start, some brought the disease from Afghanistan, that got infected there. And there was a program giving incentive to come back to Kabul. The UN system giving money to the families, saying, please come back. And people were happy because they could get some good dollars. And they come back. What the people from UN system didn't know, that during the night, the people were entering again into Pakistan to get the money twice, three times, four times. And the chief of the program told me, oh, we are so happy, doctor, because it's a full successful program. The people come back more and more. During the night, people, you know, it's so difficult to control this border that the people come back again, some money. So, typical, the tricky system. You're not sure of the results. That's the gentleman we met in the villages to to make the investigation. And here you will see a typical anthropognathic transmission in the same family, all were brother and sister, all got leishmaniasis. You can see here, 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 everybody. That's typical. And what is important to know that ACL is not always easy disease. And even ZCL, people say sometimes in Saudi Arabia, in Arabic, they used to say the little sister, because it's part of the family. Everybody will get one day ZCL, and they will cure spontaneously. ACL is more long-lasting disease, and mainly you can have these recidivance cases, or like a mucosal. And that's severe form. Look, this old person with probably immune system depressed, and she has. And I remember once I was in Geneva, and there was the press release, and people, all the newspaper people were in a room like this, and we went there to sensitize them to some problems. There were some malaria cases in Cambodia. And I went with this picture for the leishmaniasis in Afghanistan. I said, people, we have to do something for the. They say, is it a killing disease? I said, no, it's not a killing. Ah, forget it. Next point. And I fell completely. I was completely depressed when I come back. OK, let's move to visceral. I'm here. We have to push a little. That's the zoonotic VL, where you have the dog as the main reservoir here, the transmission from human to human through the vector. You have different vectors here in South America, longipal piece, and the parasite, globally, Leishmanian phantom, not to go into many details. Even in Europe, can be in, not in Trieste, I don't think so, but in Italy, in South, of course, in Sicily, in southern France. I have a friend living here in Marseille, and in the suburb, in his garden, he had sandflies and the dog and transmission of the disease. Before it was a child disease. Well, I want to go for more time to Europe because it's a small problem. Just when HIV appeared, we saw more people HIV VL because of the immunosuppression. Latin America, again, Brazil is the leader for VL. Colombia has also a lot of cases. No, that's Argentina, that's in Paraguay. Paraguay, Argentina and Colombia. Here you see Brazil with the different areas of VL. Brazil, we have around 4,000 cases per year officially reported. The system is working well. And what's the situation? That's the northeast of Brazil, typical dry environment with the cities, all the cities where you have leishmaniasis, even in the cities themselves, in Recife, Salvador, Natal, all this. And why? Because in the poor suburbs, in the favela, you can have a high density of population, poor sanitary condition, the dogs are there, and the transmission is very active. Here you see typical cases of VL, advanced cases, hepatosplenomegaly. And here you sometimes there is a wide reservoir, the fox, sorry, bringing the disease close to the house. The dog gets infected, the sandflies pick up the parasite from the dog and transmit to human. Here you see the problem of the dog, what to do with the dog. It's very difficult. For years in Brazil, the politic was to kill the seropositive dog. But people buy a new one. So you cannot solve the problem with vaccination so far. We will know later on, but we don't have a real strong vaccine for dogs. Some people suggest the collars impregnated with pyrethroid. But it's also complicated because the dog move a lot, they can destroy the collar. And I will finish with the big one, it's the anthropognathic VL, where the transmission is from human to human through the vector, and where you have this huge epidemic, we will see. Parasite, Leishmania Donovani in India, Nepal, Bangladesh, the vector phlebotomy sargentipes and human reservoir. Oh, that you know the symptoms, we can pass. Let's go to Bihar State, Patna. And what's the current situation? We still have under-reporting, but it's going to be less and less. You will see the number. What remains a problem that the private sector and some NGOs are not officially included in the reporting system. My colleague from India will confirm it. The problem is that we have the official private sector with clinics. Some of you are from Siam Sundar lab. He has a clinic. There's no problem. He's reporting the cases, of course. But you have all these people that are not officially doctors, the quacks, that have their own clinics where they treat, they diagnose. And the government doesn't want to acknowledge the existence of these wrong doctors, not official doctors. But there are many people, and they are going to the country. They have the drug in the pocket. They ask you, how much money you have? I have 200 rupees. They give you the quantity of drug corresponding to the money you have in your pocket. So that creates resistance. It's a big problem. And that's very interesting. That's the reduction of cases for the last... I got up to 2013. You see, we are half of the numbers in 2010. And it's not only India. India, 50% less. But let's see Bangladesh also. Half, and Nepal is going down also quickly. That was 2 years ago, the numbers, and what I put at that time, that the increase under-reporting could be 4 to 8-fold higher than the official number. But now we estimate that the private sector see only 20% of the cases because the better drugs are available in the public sector. Greg will tell us on some implementation research how that has been improved, this elimination program. But it's very nice to remember that 2 years ago, that was the number I gave, that was the right number. But now it's going down. Let's see. India, it's very impressive, even for 2004, in July 2014, sorry, 2014, we have less than last year. Well, that's the endemic area, oui. The classical environment for the cow dung for breeding site, the cow shelters, and the cow dung that is used to cook as a fuel. Nepal is the same evolution. Look, the number of cases going really down in 2013, 325 officially reported. There's a very low under-reporting because there is no drug in the private sector. It's really in India that you have the drug in the private sector. In Bangladesh and Nepal, not Bangladesh. Look also the number going down. Alors some people, negative people say, is it really due to the improvement of the elimination program? Is it a global tendency? Because that's true that in many parts of the world currently we see a reduction of VL. But we will see soon. That shows you the number of cases, especially among children or teenagers. That's a picture of Siam Sundar. Okay, there are still problems now with eliminating the disease. But, I don't want to anticipate the Greg talk. We should take into account the PKDL, the asymptomatics, and different factors in terms of breeding site. In some places, malnutrition, HIV, all these factors are to be taken into account if we want to succeed. The problem of asymptomatic, you see, when you see clinical cases, you see the visible part of the iceberg here. You see this part, but under the water, you have all these cases that are the asymptomatic cases. Okay, I think I won't too much on that. Some example, I want to keep a 15 minutes discussion at the end. That's PKDL. cases in the macular form, maculonodular, nodular form. We know that in some places in Sudan, we have a lot of VL patients developing PKDL. In India, Bangladesh, Nepal, it's less, it's around 10%. But what is strange that sometimes people develop PKDL without having previous VL. 10% more or less of people can develop PKDL. The incubation time is long, it's almost 2 years. And the big question that is not solved yet, and we are fighting. In the last year, I was still in charge for leishmaniasis control. I was fighting to get answer to this question. Are the PKDL cases reservoir? Are they infective? Because that's the question. If they are not, forget it. You can put your money in other things and be. But if they are infective, you have to know which form of PKDL will be the source of parasite. If it's only the nodular form or the early stage also. That's a key point. Now the NDI has put money with WHO to set up a place where you can test by xenodiagnosis, put sandflies, breeding sandflies, and take on the PKDL case and see which percentage would get infected. That's one of the few examples we have from West Bengal, from Calcutta, where sandflies, laboratory bred sandflies, were put on PKDL cases. And among those who survived, almost 50%, 3 among 60, got positive. And pick up the parasite from the PKDL. But this was nodular form. And now PKDL is going down, even in Bangladesh, what it was very frequent. We should know quickly what's the answer. Are they infective or not? That's a major research topic for the coming year. And I will finish by Sudan. I will be more recording the past because I have no really recent data you can provide. But I want to remember this huge epidemic in Western Upper Nile. It was 1990, 1991. Like it's a time ago, no? 25 years ago. But I was there, I was in charge at that time. Donc, in some areas, 50% of the population died, especially in southern Sudan. And globally, 100,000 deaths in a population of less than 1 million. That's typical of this huge epidemic that you can have in these countries with the anthropogenic form of VL. Sorry for that. It's not the Prosecco, but I have a call. And it's interesting to see that, after having a huge number of cases, there is a period of time during which people are either immune, cured, or they are dead. Donc you have no susceptible population to be infected. And it takes some years to get again new cases. Here you see the way of transmission. At that time, nomadic people used to come from Darfur, migrate to southern Sudan with the cattle and come back. And they used to get the disease in this area. And some people from Ethiopia also. It was a complex situation. Some people from Sudan went to Ethiopia for training, military training or reverse process, and the disease was moving with these people. I don't want to create a political problem now that the situation between Ethiopia and Sudan is peaceful. Here you have the main foci of VL at that time. And then the problem appeared more recently in 2009 and 10 in southern Sudan. Whatever is a severe situation, you can see at that time there were 800 VL patients under treatment, 30 new VL patients per day, you see, during the full week. Donc, that shows you how the problem can move from one place to another. You have a place where you have susceptible people, sandflies, any cases come, starting the problem. epidemic, then it goes down, and it reappears in another place. VL, typical housing, acacia forest. And then to conclude the problem of HIV Leishmania co-infection, it started to be well known in Southern Europe, and we, because in Europe, people being very well nourished, having no co-infection with tuberculosis or other problems, the immune status is globally good. Look, we have many asymptomatic cases. If you go to Southern France, you take blood, we will find a lot of asymptomatic cases. But they won't move to the disease. They will remain like this, serologically positive, but no symptoms. But the day some people got HIV, of course, immunosuppression, and then we saw the cases appearing in Spain, Portugal, France, and Italy. Look, we set up a surveillance network at that time, and we were targeting IV drug user or some population, the sex workers. But we never found a high number of co-infection, except in this work of MSF north of close to Patna and ICMR. But it was a special population already selected because they were relapsing cases of VL. And among these relapsing cases, there was 9% of co-infection. But the place where the problem is really severe is in Ethiopia. Who is from Ethiopia? I don't know. Perhaps you have more updated data. The last one I had showed this, especially in Umera. I've been there at that time. That was the reality because there were military camps. Unfortunately, when you have military people, you have some sex workers active in this area. And there was the seasonal workers coming from Addis, from the island, to this low area where you have plenty of crops. And people work for 3, 4, 6 months there, and they come back. And at that time, the rate of co-infection was huge, 40%. Gedaref was never so high. Okay, that's my talk. I wanted to give you this quick, not so quick, but overview. You see the complexity of leishmaniasis. I think it's, I had the chance to visit almost 80 countries in the world. I pick up some examples. But if you have any comment, any update to provide, please do not hesitate. There is no naive questions, no? Do not hesitate. You can ask what you want. We are in between us. It's not a diploma at the end. That's Jill Seaman, a person who worked in Southern Sudan for many years, that gave me this picture of malnutrition, VL. But I want to be optimistic, no? When you see these beautiful girls from India, you can see that it's a very neglected disease. These people are neglected population. But now there is a consensus providing more support, more interest, awareness on this VL situation in India, Nepal, Bangladesh, and Greg will complement what I have said very quickly. And we have new tools that I think we can be really optimistic when you see the number going down. Okay. We have 10, 15 minutes. Huh? Thank you.